If your goal is to reduce your landfill use and to improve air quality and water quality, commercial composting has a lot of benefits to that because it's anything that was once alive. It includes meat and dairy and compostable disposables. And we have a number of facets of what we do. So we have the door-to-door food scrap collection for residents, and we also do that for restaurants. And we'll do it for a single person who usually we keep the bucket for 4 weeks, and a family of four or more will ask us to come weekly, or sometimes actually has two buckets. And then we go into small restaurants where we have 32-gallon totes, which is a relatively small dolly cart, kind of like it's in your back, you know, for your recycling. And that container, when it's full, is probably about 125 pounds of food scraps. And so in that situation, too, we take the entire container, put it on our truck, and put down a clean, kitchen-ready tote every single time so the restaurants don't have to deal with the containers. I have found that most of my customers, you know, that really keeps them going, that they don't have to deal with any of the mess of the composting, any of the yuck factor. We try to eliminate them. We also, for larger institutions like the Merchandise Mart and Food for Thought Catering, and we have a couple of other truckload customers where they fill up 20 of our 32-gallon totes, and we do what we call a one-stop and go in and empty out all of their food scraps. So that's kind of one end of what we do. The other thing that we do is we create zero waste events. So if you have an organization that's going to have a large event, if you really it has a green focus, we help you buy compostable products, 100% paper plates, corn or potato or sugar, or there's so many different now, plant-based forks, cups, and we take that all away. We're an in-kind sponsor of the event today. We're composting downstairs in the basement by where the food is. We've done green weddings and green fairs and very large green events and help people do very intimate green events. I think that in your house, the key to keeping the compost going is how you collect it on your countertop or whatever. Some people, I don't know, when I first started, I was okay with just having the having a bucket, you know, a Tupperware or whatever. Building a wall. Sorry. I take this container and I put paper inside of it. I end up getting some brown paper pretty regularly in my daily life, and I just create it so it goes inside. I don't have to buy it, which is one of the key things that I really like about it. It does absorb odor, and most of the compostable bags leak, so the fact that the paper leaks too, I don't really care about because I'm not paying for the thing. And then when I take it outside to tip it into the container that's going to get picked up, then it just falls out, you know, because the paper just makes it go. And that's really nice. And then I just take it in the house and rinse it, and I'm ready to go again.
Do you take that paper in there?
No, I put clean paper in there.
Okay.
Yeah, no, it goes. Fruit flies.
Yeah.
Is a huge issue when you're collecting food scraps, no matter what you're going to do with them. I find that layering paper on it, if you're a paper towel user with commercial composting, any food soiled paper can go into the compost bin, so you could put your paper towels in, create a layer, or you can just keep a stash of newspaper and you know, a brown paper bag or whatever, and you know, I started to compost for 35 West Wacker a while ago, and they have a big fish restaurant called Catch 35, and they were like, what about the fish smell? What about the fish smell? What are we going to do about the fish smell? And I was like, carbon is your friend. So, you know, you've got to layer the carbon. Also, the totes are have a bag on it, so when they do fill it up, then we tie it up. They tie it off, and that keeps the odor inside, too. But so I decided, well, I keep saying all of this, carbon is your friend, and then I had this fish skin that I was ready to throw away, and I'm like, oh, I should take this outside. And I'm like, no, I'm going to put it in my countertop container, and I'm going to put some paper over it and see how long before I know that there's fish in that container. And I was keeping it on the countertop. It was in the spring, so it was before fruit fly season. And it really works, you know. So if you're dealing with any kind of odor, you know, getting more paper on top, whether it's your vermiculture bin or if you're taking it to your yard, you know, the paper is super helpful. So we are a resource for all different kinds of composting, but we definitely, you know, we would love to take from you anything that you can't put in your yard or aren't feeding to your worms, and we would love for you to shout out to your neighborhood restaurants and the places that you go to tell them about what the, you know, what green options they have. So we go all the way up the North Shore to Highland Park, and we go all the way down in Chicago to the South Loop. We're mostly east of Waukegan Road or 94 until you get down closer to the city, and then we're in Jefferson Park and Logan Square and stuff. So then there's some neighborhoods that we've moved into. So, and it expands. We do go out to Rosemont. We service U.S. Foods out there, and we go to Morton Grove for Catering by Michael. So it depends on your volume, you know, and if it's worth our while.
So you've never gone before yourself in the Southwick?
What?
You've never gone before yourself in the Southwick, you said?
Well, we're I'd love to counter Cook County. I'd like to, you know, have that be our boundaries relatively soon. We got funded in the spring by the state of Illinois to expand, and we're setting up a container washing facility.
On the High Park. So we have four or five different gardens, you know, it's a collective. That would, this would be something that we just really need to do.
So I'm not wanting to take over from a speaker standpoint, but I see excitement over here in her eyes that she can't see well at from a speaker standpoint from a Hyde Park conversation. So you might want to chat with her too from a composting.
Yeah. So you're on our way to the commercial composting site. So if you do have a group of people who are interested, you know, I'm always expanding. So, you know, it's kind of interesting. It's been a slow process to grow.
Yeah.
You know, I've been at it for coming up on 4.5 years, and we have 350 residential customers. I think that if it was easy, we would have thousands of customers. You know, I mean, we live in a metropolis, very big, big city, but a lot of people still don't quite understand, or if they do understand the importance of reducing what we're putting in the landfill, they, you know, they're just not willing to either take the time to sort of separate or to pay for the service. And since I'm not independently wealthy,
you'll take meat.
It would take meat and dairy and food soil paper, greasy pizza box. The Whole Foods graciously does all of that really nice compostable paper on their salad bar now. And we don't take like the thin paper, like McDonald's paper, because that's all plastic coated, but anything that's 100% paper. Linda downstairs is doing lunch in 100% paper boats, and so we'll be taking all of those off-site along the
you can do meat, because that's the one thing I remember from composting, no meat products.
But, okay, so you're talking about in a yard or in a garden, and the pile is relatively small, and it's only going to reach a certain temperature inside of that pile. Mm-hmm. We're talking about windrow composting, where the piles are 18 feet wide and 9 feet tall, and it's mixed with yard waste, it's mixed with leaves, it's mixed with grass cuttings, it's ground up, and the inside of these piles, even in the winter time when they move these piles, it leaves a steaming track on the ground. You can tell exactly where they are in their rotation because they've got a steaming pile and a steaming track on the ground where it once was. So the heat alone, but if you think about it in nature, where does the deer go when it dies in the woods? It decomposes. I mean, somebody eats it, whether it's, you know, maggots, worms.
Do you have a lot, your client composition, is it mostly, restaurants and retail?
The volume comes from the restaurants. We have more residential customers than we do restaurants.
You do have more residential customers. Are they generally large buildings or small?
We really do it all. We do single family homes where they don't have the space to do it, but they want to reduce the landfill use. So we do from them. We service Soho East, which is a multi-unit building, and we take so everybody in that building who wants to contribute, they have buckets in their trash room, and so they do it that way. We have smaller condo buildings where they have a 32-gallon tote like the restaurants, and then it's in their backyard and everybody fills into it. We really want to create a system that works wherever you want to compost.
So, I mean, I'm paying you to take away my compostable items. What do I get? Do I get compost every year?
Well, okay, eventually, but not currently. So, we really only have one commercial composting site. There are actually two. One of them is with Growing Power, and they have a finished product that you can buy. But because we do meat and dairy, we can really only haul to Harborview at 122nd in Stony Island, and they take they take grass clippings from everywhere. And they're chemically treated, and so their finished product is really geared towards landscaping. So it's not been something that I've been bringing back to my customers because I wouldn't really recommend it for gardening. The other thing is my truck is really dirty. So for me to go down to Harborview and to get finished product means we have to, power wash the inside of the truck, and it's not like we can go down there, drop off food scraps, and pick up compost and come back. So it would be an expense. It would be another cost of the service because if I really charge what it costs us to take it down to Harborview, so it's it really the mission is to get as much into to be composted. And we're moving 12 to 15 tons a week now. So we've made a lot of headway. We hit our 500 ton milestone at the end of 2013, and we'll probably do another 500 tons this year.
What happens with your compost after it's ready to be?
It's owned by Waste Management at Harborview. It's their Harborview site, so. It's mostly for landscaping, so they sell it to landscapers. The Illinois Department of Transportation uses it, and it's sold to Scott's Lawn Care and mixed in with their seeds and weed prevention. Compost of any sort on your lawn or in your bushes or anywhere is such a great thing. Use finished compost. A lawn that is aerated and treated with compost once or twice a year retains 75% more water. There's amazing amount of lack of runoff, and then there's no chemicals. should at least be taking the leftover plants